Hi, I'm International Grandmaster Ron W. Henley, and this is the iChess Karpov Master Method, Chapter 1. We're going to look at early games and classics from his career. One of the best ways to build a solid chess foundation and improve in chess is to study the complete games of the great players. In this section, Anatoly will look at three nice games from early in his career as a teenage boy, and then he will examine four more of his finest masterpieces in the years leading up to his FIDE World Championship match with Gadakhamsky in 1996. These are the instructive kind of games that you can play through again and again and incorporate many of the techniques such as prophylaxis and delayed gratification into your own chess play. Here's Anatoly Karpov, the 12th world champion. Anatoly, can you explain to the viewers some of the games that you will be covering in this section?
Yeah, I selected games which were played on a very high level. And the first game I want to present to you, a game against Soviet Union National Master Ravinsky, who was responsible in our federation for youth and children chess. And he was one of the best trainer. Actually, he was training many of leading chess players from Soviet Union. And this game is classical Spanish, how to play Spanish with black. Another game I played against Sergeyevsky, who was international master at that time. Game was played in Russian championship in 1970. And this is a remarkable game because you can see how you can win the game maneuvering only on the first and second rank. And at the end, it was a nice combination, which allowed me to create mates. And another game against Yugoslavian master Vujaković. I played that game in a match, youth match, Soviet Union-Yugoslavia in 1968. And it was peace defense, and I got big space advantage. And then you can see how to develop advantage and how to make progress with this. Another game, Karpov Geek. This game was played in a championship of Moscow State University. I became the winner of this, even I was younger of all the players. And this game is very interesting because this is extremely interesting tactical game with a lot of ideas, tactical ideas, mating attack. And then another game I want to present to you, game against Ricardo Calvo. I played this game in Madrid International Tournament in 1973. I was already grandmaster at that moment. And the game is interesting because at certain moment you would see that white king and a queen and rook just happened to be in the corner, and it was very difficult to get them back. And this is probably a unique situation in tournament chess. Another game, Karpov and Seeker. This game was played in Chess Olympiad in Nice in 1974. Und Seeker was leading West German team, and I was leading Soviet Union team. So this is a well-known game, classical game in Spanish variation or Ray Lopez variation. Of course, we give commands on this game. And another game I played against international grandmaster Boris Gulko. This was Queen's Gambit accepted. I had slight advantage, which white could transform in big advantage with the interesting exchange sacrifice. And then it was the way how to reach the win with technical methods, even without exchange.
I played this game when I was 15, and Dravinsky was over 60, very experienced player in the Soviet Union. And this game was played in the tournament where I pretended to become the youngest national master in Soviet Union. e4e5, knight f3. So e4e5, Roy Lopez, I played black. Knight f3, knight c6. So the opening moves doesn't need any commands. a6, bishop a4, knight f6, castle, bishop e7, rook e1. What? He played queen e2?
Mm-hmm.
Ah, so bishop e7, queen e2. So it's possible. White has slight advantage after queen e2, and this is just to avoid the martial attack. So bishop b3, d6, c3, castle, rook d1. Now if you play d4, then bishop g4 is possible. That's why rook d1, then knight to a5, bishop c2, c5, d4, queen c7. And it looks like classical Chigorin, but in Chigorin variation, white would have queen on d1, rook on a1, and then pawn on h3. Here, pawn on h3, and then black to move, rook e8. Of course, it's useful to have a rook against the queen. And later I wanted to exchange on d4 and to have pressure on e4 pawn. That's why white is changing now on e5, b takes e5, d takes e5, knight b to d2, then rook d8. So this is just to decrease pressure, white pressure in the center. It's better to have one rook less in the position. So, and also I gain tempo taking on d1, then bishop takes on d1, or queen takes on d1. Queen takes on d1, and then doesn't matter. c4, this is the main line. I want to bring knight to c5 and to occupy square d3. Bishop c5. Bishop e6, yeah. Queen e2, both ways are possible. Knight b7, knight to g3, and then knight to g3. Then, in principle, it's always, when it's possible, it's always good to have pawn on g6 against knight on g3, or pawn on b6 against knight on b3, or pawn on b3 against knight on b6. And here, knight from g3 has no big future, and black has time to regroup pieces. Rook to d1. Rook to d8. Then rook takes d8, bishop takes d8, queen goes to e3, and then knight to d7. So we want just to occupy black squares after exchange of bishops. Of course, I retreat with the knight. And then in case of knight g5, f6, knight takes e6, knight takes e6, I have already slight advantage because white bishop is not active, and so we have good squares, black color squares on f4 and c5, and then we have perspective on d3. So this already slight advantage for black. That's why white played queen to h6. Then we play f6, of course. We don't allow knight to come to g5. Queen e3. a5. So in general, the idea is to play b4 and then to play b3 and to have passed pawn on b later on b3 after we break through this a4 a3 h4. Now we must control white activity and so on. B4, h5, yes, and then king to g7. So it's not dangerous to allow pawn to come to h6, because after h6 check, we can go to king to f8, and then after knight f7, pawn will be under attack. Okay, coming back. Bishop d1. So now we have time to defend our king. Knight on f7 is very good. Exchange, then we exchange. Knight to d2, and then knight to c5. So I try to neutralize activity, black activity on the queen side. If they would play bishop on e2, then black would play b3. Not instead of b3, if you play bishop e2, then b3 is possible. And if you play a3, then knight a4, and there is no way to protect pawn on b2. And if not a3, knight on c5, pawn is there. When you exchange, then we take on b3 is pawn, and then knight a4 is threat. And we have this perspective to make pass pawn. So b3, we take on b3, then pawn should take, because if you recapture with minor piece like knight or bishop, then we exchange on b3 with the knight, then take again, and then we take pawn on c3. It's big advantage. Okay, a takes b3, and then queen to b6. Of course, we want to take on b4 after exchange, pawn exchange. We want to take back with the queen. Then we have pressure on b3 pawn. Knight g2 f1, knight d6, c4. So maybe this is positionally not so good, but black wanted to play knight to b5 and then to bring knight to d4 after exchange, pawn exchange. and then it will be difficult to defend pawn on b3. And in case of c takes b4, queen takes b4, and then still we are bringing knight to d4. Queen c6, very important move. We force white to defend pawn on e4, bishop c2, a4. Then bishop takes here, now on c4. It's better to take with the bishop, because if we recapture with the knight, then we lose one tempo. Knight takes c4, bishop takes c4, knight d2, and then white would have possibility to play later on, maybe a5, or even to block this service. No, a5 would be better. Okay. So bishop takes, knight goes to g3, and then if white would take on c4, knight c4, queen e2, and then knight a3, very unpleasant. And knight takes a4 is threat, and if white would play a5, then knight takes c2, queen takes c2 and b3. And then queen b5, and then pawn is very, very dangerous. Of course, we don't give chance to take our bishop on f7, and then later on we try to play b3. So a5, then queen b5. Now f4 is the only possible way to make some counterplay. Queen takes a5. And then this is quite unpleasant, because we have check on a1. Then queen takes c. Then what to do? Knight f3. Yeah, queen b2. This is extremely strong. Extremely strong, and then when white takes on c5, b3 is coming. Now we have threat to take on c2. And white played knight d4. Then we take on c2. Probably white didn't consider this, but after knight takes c2, knight c4, there is no defense, and knight will be lost on c2. And already no moves, because if queen takes c2, then queen takes d4, and knight g3 cannot go to e2, because knight takes e4 fork, and the only move is knight d2 e2. Knight takes e4 fork, and we win queen. And if knight d2 e2, then knight c4. And then if e5, then c1 queen. And e takes f6 check, queen takes f6. Winning. Very, very clear game. And typically how black should take initiative in Ruy Lopez with in Ruy Lopez. This game was played in junior match Soviet Union Yugoslavia, and I played with white pierce defense against Vujakovic. H3. I don't know why I played H3, so it doesn't give too much advantage. And later on I switched to knight f3, or I played even f4, but h3 is an accurate move, so I prepare my bishop to come to e3, and then it will not be disturbed by knight g4. So c6, bishop e3, castle, and then queen. You are too quick, and we missed three. No, just
we didn't reset the pieces. Yes. Okay, hold on.
Soviet Union versus Yugoslavia on the junior board. I played the Yugoslavian player Vujakovic. It was pieces. So pierce defense, in which white has space advantage, but black tried to counterattack on the queen side. So if we d6 d4 knight f6 knight c3, then h3, preparing bishop e3, and this bishop will not be disturbed by knight g4. Later on, I changed my repertoire and started to play knight f3 or f4, but that time h3 was quite good. Bishop e3, castle, queen d2, c6, g4. e5, and then long castle, I believe, yeah. And then, of course, threat is d takes e5, and black should defend. Yes, queen to e7, d5. Yeah, this is important. Now, if c takes d5, then probably g5, and then we control d5 square. And if black would play d4, not d4, yes, or if c takes d5, g5, if d4, then we can capture on f6, and then capture there, then on c3, then we capture on e7, take, rook takes, and then after rook there, rook takes d6. Rook e7 is not possible because rook d8 check and rook takes c8. And if we continue, it's not that g5, d4, d4, pawn takes knight, any recapture on f6, knight d5, and then there is check. Knight d5 and check on e7 or check on f6 later on. Yes. Then we go back d4, g takes f6, and d takes c3. And here we just saw f takes e7, but let's finish this. F takes e7, pawn takes d2, rook takes d2, rook e8, rook d6, and then knight c6. And here we play bishop b5. And then if bishop e6, then rook takes c6. And this is forked by bishop. So we are coming back. Black played c5. And so now we have time for our actions on the king side. King, knight g2 e2, knight a6. Because if black would play b5, so most probably we could play g5. b5, g5. g5, and then if take e b4, then we take f6, and so this is the same line with clear advantage for white. If take on c3, then we can take on e7, take on d2, then rook takes d2, rook e8, and then knight to c3. Okay, then we come back. So black played knight to a6. Knight to g3. Now we have comfortable g5, and then we prevented knight go. Black knight goes to h5. If knight cannot go to h5, then this is a good advantage for white. First we can play king b1, and then knight goes to e8. And then we play bishop e2. Now f5 would be positionally wrong, because we simply take on f5 all the times, and then we have clear advantage of very active and very strong white color bishop. No, it's not necessary to play bishop g4. Not necessarily play bishop g3. We can just to come to g5. Bishop e2, then bishop d7, or rook b8, and then we have just time for this. Rook d to g1, then b5. And then we play h4, of course having in mind that we later play h5 and we start our attack on the king side. So before knight to d1, so we control c4 square, which is very important. Knight to b5. So we are not afraid of knight c3 check. because we don't take with the pawn. Otherwise, it will be open check, and then we lose our queen. But knight takes c3, pawn takes c3, queen takes c3. So knight comes to d4. c4. So this is positional sacrifice of pawn. Maybe this is doubtful. Still, black has no enough compensation for that pawn. Knight d4 would be, I think, would be more logical way. But of course, we play g5 after this. And then probably black afraid of this attack, starting with f3, and then queen quickly comes to h2, and then it will be very dangerous on the king side. So c4. But still, black should find another way how to try to develop initiative on the queen side. So queen takes b4. This was in the game?
No, this was the game.
No, this is the game, yes. So queen takes b4. Then knight e to c7. Of course, we cannot take on c4 because knight, if we take with queen, knight a3 check. And okay, we lose the queen. And then if you take with the bishop, then bishop takes g4, and black has good initiative, knight on c7. So queen d2. Bishop goes to d7. Yeah, this was the idea, just to stop knight coming to d4, and later on probably we can take on c4. So now we have a5, king a1, a4. Knight f5. This is very important. And this is typical sacrifice of knight, which can happen in Spanish, in Ruy López, typical sacrifice with knight on f5, or in King's Indian, or in Pierce defense. Knight to f5, then take on f5, g takes f5, and then if king goes to h8, then we just take, king takes an f6 check, king takes f6, and bishop g5, just winning queen. Queen d8. It happened?
No, if he tries.
Well, the most important thing that we just defended our pawn on g4. This is knight goes to e7, knight, nice mate. So then bishop f5 is a takes f5 is the only move. G takes f5. Then a3. This is a attempt to get some counterplay on the king's side, but this is too late. H takes g6. Pawn takes on b2, check, knight takes b2. And then take on g6. F takes g6. So actually, rook a8 is the only chance to try to do something, but there is no way how to get any activity because king is too exposed. And then bishop takes c4, rook a3, and then bishop h6. This is the correct order of moves. Now g takes h7, big threat. H takes g6, rook takes g6. And of course, knight e8 is not possible because bishop takes b5, so rook f4, and then simply rook g1 and knight e8. And bishop takes b5. Rook g1. And if knight e8, then bishop takes b5. Winning. Okay, then we make game with Sergeyevsky. Do we record?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So another piece defense, which was popular in 70s. This game was played in Russian Championship in 1970. And this was important for me because I was that moment not grandmaster, but I was trying to get this norm, and I played in Russian Championship with several grandmasters participated, and so it was symbolic that I could win the Russian Championship. Sergeyevsky was strong international master at that time. e4d6, d4, knight f6, knight c3, knight b2d7. So this quite rare variation of pierce defense. Knight is coming to d7 too early. And then knight g2 e2. I think this is logical because then in case of f3, knight on on d7 is a little bit early, as I said, and then I can easily develop my pieces. Knight g2 e2, b5. This is actually interesting. So black tries to get some initiative on the queen side, and now white could play a3 or knight g3, attacking pawn, but I prefer the technical way, e5. Yes, I take on e5, and then if knight g4, then e6, and then we capture on b5 or knight d4. Yes, with a very, very strong position. So that's why knight takes to e5, Then queen takes d8, king takes d8, knight takes b5, bishop f4 is threat, so black should play. What? Not this. Not important. So just break, yeah. Knight takes b5. And so white is not ahead in development of pieces, but white has much better pawn structure because c7 and a7, two islands, pawn islands, and so we can attack them later on. But it's not easy. It's not easy to use this small advantage. And the game is very interesting because I could demonstrate interesting technique. A6. Knight b to d4, then bishop b7. Bishop f4, it's important to kick out the knight from the active position to the center. So this is very, very interesting. In case of knight takes f4, we have double check, knight e6 and mate in both lines. King c8, rook d8 mate, or king e8, knight takes c7 mate. And long castle is this very important move in between. King c8 is the only move. Now we play bishop d2. This only square where we can escape from attack of the knights. E6, then we play knight to b3, not allowing bishop to come to active position on c5, and also controlling square a5 square. Knight g4. Then bishop e1, the only way how to protect pawn on f2 and defend ourselves from fork on f2. Bishop d6, h3. Yes, this is another fine moment, because otherwise we should have to play knight to g3 to defend pawn on h2, but then black would have possibility to play knight h4 to attack our pawn on g2, and after f3 knight comes to e3, but h3 and knight h2 is not possible because rook takes d6, knight takes f1, rook d3. We protect our pawn on h3, and after bishop takes g2, rook g1, and then we simply win the game after this. This is big advantage with two pieces against rook and one pawn. And so black retreated knight to f6, then knight a5. And bishop cannot escape, so this is a problem. Because if bishop e4, then we play f3. If bishop d5, we play c4, bishop e4, f3, and g4. And we win the bishop. So black had to give up this bishop. Now it goes to d8, c4. We are not in a hurry. We can wait a little bit. Yes, knight going there. Knight takes b7, king takes b7. So if black would take on e2, then bishop takes b2, and then we have clear the advantage of two bishops. King c2. Look, this is a very, very interesting position because all white pieces on the are on the first rank, but position is almost winning. So it's huge advantage for white because of pawn structure and the advantage of two bishops over a bishop and knight. So black played rook d8, then g3. Okay, we bring this knight back from the active position. Then bishop g2 check. This is important. So probably better was c6, not to expose king too far. But after c6, knight c3, it's clear advantage for white. So king b6. So it gave me opportunity to organize interesting attack and to win the game unusual way. Bishop d4, knight to e2, bishop e5, and then we play f4, bishop goes there, and then knight to c3. Now king is too far, and so bishop f2 is big threat, because after c5 check, knight a4 check. And so black tried to escape this c6 to be able after bishop f2 check to come to c7 and then knight d7, so black would be able to organize some kind of defense. But here very important moment and unusual combination. C4, C5, check. So king takes C5, bishop F2 check, king B4, SV check. Takes, king takes, rook B1, and both, no, three. Three moves, king a3, rook b3 mate, king a5, bishop b6 mate, and king c4, bishop f1 check, rook b3, bishop takes the three mate. That's why king c5 is not good, but also there is another possibility after king takes c5, bishop f2 check. King goes to goes to c4. Then we can play bishop f1 check, king b4, bishop b6, and there is no defense against a3 mate. Also very interesting net. So bishop takes c5, then knight a4 check, king b5, then we play b3, or king b3, yes, king b3. And bishop f1 mate is big threat. So black should play rook to d3 and then bishop c3. So bishop f1 is winning easily. After taking this, yes, take there, and there is no escape. Knight a4, bishop f2, and then rook c1. And if bishop takes on g3, rook c5 mate. Okay. Black bishop cannot leave the diagonal because of rook c5 mate. Yes. That's why bishop e3 and then bishop takes c6. Okay. Finish. Oh, it's winning position, so not necessary to make all this. Just play e3, threatening b4 mate, knight b6 check, king d3. Again, b4 threatening mate, knight takes a4, then b4 check. King b6 and king takes e3, and then we win knight on a4. Game ends. Usual game. Actually, it's not easy to win the game just maneuvering on the first and second rank. But white succeeded here because of tactical possibilities, open position of black king. Which sounds also a little bit strange. Open position, and the king is in danger on c7, b7, b6, while all white pieces on the first rank, knight on d1, bishop on e1, bishop on f1, and the rook in the corner on h1. But after c5, this was forced movement.